In this course, we've celebrated many of the positive sides of urban life, but of course, there are also demons that come with density. And certainly one of the worst of those demons is that when people live close to one another, diseases can hop from person to person to be being carried by animals or just in the water stream. And for thousands of years, cities have been battling epidemics which have broken out occasionally. What are the first of these urban epidemics that we see in the historical record?
Well, people talk about the plague of Athens as being an early plague in a city. Athens was a city-state, although I'd never seen pictures of what Athens was like, I'm sure it was crowded. People massed together in public places to hear Pericles, among others.
Right.
Actually, the sanitation in Athens was probably better than it was in most European cities that we're more familiar with. But still people were crowded together. Interestingly, we actually don't know what the quote-unquote plague of Athens was. It certainly was not the bubonic plague or the Black Death. And since we don't know exactly what it was, we can't be sure about how it was transmitted. But more than likely, the close proximity of people, the lack of what we call social distancing was a factor. So when people flock into the cities, it's inevitably going to cause a greater urban density and increase the chance of the spread of infection.
And cities like Athens are also entry points, right? They're great ports that welcome in boats. Then those boats may themselves be carrying the plague. And then we have the big one, Justinian's plague in the 6th century. What do we know about Justinian's plague? So this happens in Constantinople, right, the mega city of its time.
Yeah, in a very crowded place, for sure, and during a time of a lot of strife. And we know that this is the bubonic plague, that this is caused because we've been able to find the DNA from the bacteria in dental pulp, among other places.
Right. And the wider social implications of it? I mean, it's sometimes alleged that this plague stopped Justinian's steamroller through Italy and the reunion of the Roman Empire. You think that's merely speculation?
I don't think it's speculation. I mean, it depends who gets hit, right?
Right.
So the plague may be raging in your camp, but it will tend to break out in your enemy's camp as well. So the balance of factors is pretty
It's just like throwing a big stochastic element into almost a third combatant, the plague, which takes down both.
And others, you know, we're not going to talk about these other diseases, but for example, typhus during the more modern wars and trench warfare, huge toll. Diarrheal diseases in the Crimean War, enormous players, and malaria in World War II in the Pacific Amphitheater took far more casualties than the war itself and was a major factor in who was prevailing.
So there are a number of possibilities for why the plague seemed to have been disappeared for five centuries or so. I guess it's also a possibility that we had less of this because we had smaller cities. Right, Europe greatly deurbanized after the fall of Rome, and you had a lot more social space. And less trade as well.
Yeah, most power was concentrated within a day's ride of your city.
Right.
So you could have a strong potentate, but you didn't have any trade and you didn't have any discourse even in the country.
So a disconnected, poorer, less urban Europe, in some sense, was a little bit safer from at least infectious diseases.
Right.
And then you have, let's call it after the year 1000, you have the rise of an urban Europe again, an increasingly connected Europe. The Crusaders rebuild, you know, some form of links to the Middle East. Trade routes get stronger and then connected to China through the Silk Road. Great cities rise again in Italy and the north. And then, of course, plague reappears in the 14th century. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so it was in the East, right? I mean, plague, first of all, is always with us in the rodent population. There are a number of animals that can harbor the plague. So it's always around, and the triggers for getting it to be transported, probably on trade routes from the East to Kaffa, which was a major trade center where there were sturgeon from the Don River and furs from Siberia, and everybody was coming through Kaffa. That's where plague began to appear. You may remember that the I never know whether one calls them the Tatars or the, mm-hmm. but they were hurling plague bodies into the city mm-hmm. to produce an epidemic, and that's actually one of the earliest biological warfare examples we have. And we now know, obviously, that rats and fleas are the mm-hmm. ways in which it spread, but a lot of people, a lot of rats, a lot of fleas, and it spread. And then in boats going to Genoa, mm-hmm. The plague, probably the rats, were on board, and then you had plague breakout in the Italian ports.
So it starts in Genoa, which is, along with Venice, one of the two great maritime powers mm-hmm. of Italy during this time period. And then it spreads first across Italy and then across Europe.
Yeah, pretty quickly, actually. Within a year or two, or at most three, it reached all the way up into Britain.
Right. Right, which I guess is a tribute to the strength of rebuilt trade routes in
Europe
during
Romans
the 14th century.
Built